Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. In preparation to Ramadan this year, there will be some series about different topics to get us at our maximum and optimum to take full advantage of Ramadan and bi-idhnillah live on that energy after it ends. I will start this time here with a talk that I teach on Wednesday on how to interact with Al-Quran, because it's crucial to understand what the Book of Allah is all about. Most people these days have a general opinion, not something that is specific to them. In this first part of how to interact with Al-Quran, I will reveal...
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Today inshallah is going to be the very first topic about interacting about Al-Quran, with Al-Quran. And why interacting? Why not understanding? Why? Because usually what Allah wants from us is looking into the Quran with the intention of practice. You have to interact with what's in it. The ability of translating what's in it is really, really great. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not limit it. He left it open. Ask yourself this question. Why don't we have a tafsir of Rasulullah? Every time he received Quran, he could have just gathered the Sahaba and started making the tafsir, right? And then we would have good, beautiful explanation of the Quran. Wouldn't that be awesome? It would be, right? But why didn't it happen? Why didn't Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam explain the Quran? Why do we have tafsir Ibn Kathir and the Sahaba didn't have tafsir of Rasulullah? Because if Allah let our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam give the meaning to Quran, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would give it a meaning that is relevant to his time. And because Al-Quran is not a timed book, not for a particular era, it's for until the end of the time. From Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam until the end of time, this is one era. The Quran is for that era. Before, the Torah and the Gospel, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them to the children of Israel, He let the children of Israel safeguard and protect the Book of Allah. The Torah and the Gospel, the Torah of Musa alayhi salam and the Gospel of Jesus, it was the responsibility of the rabbi and priests to preserve it. What did they do? They messed it up. They played with the text, they changed, they did, as you see it today. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did, for us Muslims, He gave us Al-Quran, but He didn't give us the responsibility to safeguard it. Because if He gave it to us, we would have messed up the Quran great, just like the Hadith. But what He did give us, He gave us the Sunnah. He left it to us. And look at the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how today it is a big mess. Just like the Torah, like it's a big mess. So this here gives you an idea that Allah did not want to specifically restrict Al-Quran to a period of time, to an era. But He left it, as I said, open. Another thing also, when I have already explained this before, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, a lot of Muslims make this mistake when they speak to people. They say Allah protects Al-Quran. Allah does not protect Al-Quran. Because Al-Quran is the book that you have. The touchable one is what you touch with your hand. This is Al-Quran. Allah has said in Surah Al-Hijr, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. It is us that have sent down Al-Dhikr. Al-Dhikr, Allah didn't say إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا Al-Quran. He didn't call it Al-Quran, he called it Al-Dhikr. Al-Dhikr is what you utter with your mouth. That is what is protected. If you go all over the world, Al-Fatiha is always recited the same. Al-Baqarah, always recited the same. The sequence of the surah, always recited the same. In the masjid, if the imam makes a mistake, you will always, always, always find somebody who will correct them. Regardless of that. The way we recite Al-Quran is the protected. What is the difference between protection of the Quran and why Allah called it a dhikr? Called it a dhikr. The word dhikr is what you utter with your mouth. And that's when somebody says, I do a dhikr, is when they say, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, it's mentioned. If Allah said He will protect Al-Quran, we would have a big problem. The Quran today would still be exactly as it were at the time of Rasulullah. On bones, on different... on leather skins and all that kind of stuff. So alhamdulillah that Allah didn't protect the Quran, because now we can print it small, we can print it big, we can print it with colors, we can print it black and white, and we can print it in gold, and we can do all these things. If Allah had protected, we would not be able to. It will always be the same copy wherever you go. Okay, so this is very, very important. The other thing that I want to mention here before I go, what does the word Quran mean? If you ask the regular Muslim out there, they will straight away tell you Quran, and they will start to think of Qara'a. Qara'a means read. And they will tell you Quran is the thing that you read. But that's not true. Al-Quran is not named Quran because it is what you read. Qara'a, when you take the root word Qara'a, Qara'a, it has few meanings. It could mean read, it could mean convey, and it could mean join together. All of which Allah used in Al-Quran in the book itself. For example, joining together when he spoke about the iddah of women, how much time they should wait. Thalathata quru. So Al-Qara' is Qara'a, Qara', all this, it's either read, convey, and join together. The Quran, the book what we recite for us, is the third meaning, is this guy here. Because we join together the ayat that were revealed. If you recite one ayah, it's part of the Quran, it's not the Quran. So when you take ayat, comes in a sequence, one after the other. We don't have an ability to change the order of the ayat. Nobody can. It's the way they are. And that's how they are. So for us, the Quran is when we join the ayat together, both in recitation and in the meaning. We convey it to people and we read it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Arabic is so powerful, that Allah uses one word, it has the main meaning, and then it has auxiliary meanings, other different meanings. So when you say Al-Quran, what you are saying is, all those ayat in the book of Allah that are tied together, that you read and you have to convey. This is Al-Quran. When Allah revealed Al-Quran at the beginning, He revealed it to the extremely clever, to the not so clever. At the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, all the Sahaba were not at the same level intellectually. They were the smart ones and not the so smart ones. But when Allah revealed to them Al-Quran, they understood it. They didn't have to resort to any tafsir. And they didn't ask someone else. They go to Abdullah ibn Abbas, what do you think the ayah means? Your understanding is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold you accountable on the day of Al-Qiyam. You understand now why? This era at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those that came after him was really, really a good era, because people were considered people. Today we are considered idiots. The moment you open your mouth about the Quran, they will tell you, what did Ibn Kathir say? You always have to tell to somebody else what X has said. So for us today, Ibn Kathir did a job that Rasulullah didn't do. And now we are stuck in his time. Because when he made his tafsir, he made it according to what Allah gave him, the knowledge that he had at that moment there. The events, the incidents, how much innovation, knowledge, technology they had at that time there. He gave his tafsir with what he was able to. If Ibn Kathir was today present with us today, he would give it a completely different tafsir. About 700 years. One thing, if you look in the British Parliament or Constitution, if you look at the British Parliament Constitution that existed 700 years ago, that ruled England according to this Constitution, based on 700 years ago. Today, in the time where we are today, if we brought this constitution, which exists, by the way, that ruled England 700 years ago, and we told people we want to run the country today based on this 700 years ago constitution, what do you think? It won't happen. It won't happen. Certain things still remain from 700 years ago, human rights and a few other things. But there are other laws that changed. We don't have them. Our problems, Muslims today, is we live in the 21st century and they ask us to apply the constitution that was 700 years ago, 1300 years ago, 1400 years ago. And this is why the problem we have today is so big. You heard people, they say, we want the law of Allah, we want the Sharia, we want the Islamic rule, the Islamic State, right? What is the Islamic State? If I ask any question, what is an Islamic State? What kind of law should we apply? We have one Islam, one Prophet, one Quran, right? But you see, if you go to the Muslim countries, whenever now there is revolution, you find different Muslim groups fighting each other. Who wants to apply Islam, right? Now, if we have one Islamic law, why don't we have it as a constitution written? Everybody tells you we want to apply the book of Allah. What part of the book of Allah do you want to apply? We today, sadly, we live in an illusion of a non-existent something called the Sharia law. Because when you go to any law in Islam, there is at least 10 different sayings. Which one are you going to go for? The problems we have today is because we are living on, and this is like it burns my heart to no end, is that in Islam today, they want us to apply constitutions that have gone up to 1,400 years ago. But here, it's the same thing, the same law. Obviously, you deduce, but it's the same law. Nothing changes. Nothing changes. One of the biggest evil about this book of Allah. Allah says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. The month of Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was revealed. We Muslims did something evil. We call Ramadan the month of the Quran. You heard this, right? Ramadan is the month of the Quran. What does that mean? The rest of the 11 months are not the months of Quran. Only Ramadan. And that's why you see a lot of people in Ramadan reading Quran and Taraweeh and all that spirit. Ramadan goes back for 11 months. Hardly ever people read the Quran on a daily basis. Because Ramadan is not the month of the Quran as they understand it. Ramadan is the month in which Al-Quran was revealed. And as I explained before, and I just briefly, the whole month of Ramadan is a build-up to Laylatul Qadr. The whole month. You know when you train and you practice for football? Yeah, you train and they take you to some Hawaii island. You practice the train. What for? It's for to play, when the game that you will need to play. So the whole month of Ramadan is because of one night. It's a whole build-up. The whole purpose of the Salat is the build-up for the Sujood. The whole purpose of Sadaqah is the build-up for Zakat. The whole purpose of Umrah is a build-up for Hajj. But we took it upon ourselves to completely change the message of Allah. Allah didn't say Ramadan Shahrul Quran, but we changed it. Why? Because somebody somewhere in our past constitutions in the 1400 had said that Ramadan is the month. Ramadan is the month of Quran, and they tell you the fuqaha of Islam, they would close all other books except the Quran. What understanding did you get from here? It's for the whole year, Al-Quran was on the shelf, and their books of fiqh and history and things like that were in front of them. When Ramadan comes in, close the whole thing. There is not an evil that is far evil than an error in an education or in something important. And that error keeps traveling with us. And when you realize it's an error, instead of it being changed, they ask you to change your brain to accept that error. And this is what's happening today. What it is asked of us today as Muslims when it comes to the Quran. Al-Quran is a progressive book, meaning it progresses with every era. Al-Quran is a book, and I'm going to write it. Al-Quran is the speech of a living God, and that is Allah, given to living humans to understand and apply. Al-Quran is alive. We humans to die. That's it. Allah is alive now. Anyone objects to this, this idea? Nobody does, right? He's alive now. My father is dead. If I had recorded his voice or filmed him and had a video clip of him and talks to me, can I say that my father is alive talking to me now? Even though I'm listening to his voice? No, because he's dead. That's a recording, right? I talk to you now because I am alive. The words that come out of my mouth are alive. And they go to a human that is alive. This is a Quran. Whatever you read here in this book here is Allah virtually speaking to you. Now, he is alive You are alive. The communication system between you two is alive. Allah doesn't talk to the dead people or to people that are unborn or that have gone past. Allah doesn't talk to them. Allah talks to you. So the most evil thing that we can go through is an error in the past that keeps traveling with us. And here is the biggest error. Normally, maths, let's take the example of maths. Maths is a science that has existed for thousands of years. The pyramids were built with maths. A lot of things were maths, okay? So at least 5,000, 6,000. Now, if we brought the most clever person 3,000 years ago with what he knew about maths, our world today in the world of maths, do you think he'll understand something? He won't, because things have changed, the means have changed. How about if we liked maths at one period of time, let's say where the Greeks were great, the maths of their time, 2,000 years ago, and then we stuck to the understanding of maths based on their understanding. Do you think we'll be advanced today with the phones and planes and things like that? We wouldn't. The problem is, we Muslims, we tell people, you have to be Muslim in the 21st century, but you have got to understand Al-Quran 1400 years ago. That's our problem. This is why we are lost. This is why we have no connection with Al-Quran at all, as we'll see today. Year after year after year, everything evolved. Government constitutions evolved. Geography evolved. History evolved. Physics evolved. Chemistry evolved. Math evolved. Everything evolved, right? Except the Quran. Al Quran is like maths are not progressive. It's not a progressive science, maths. Maths is a philosophy. Now there are rules in, you see, how discoveries, how we approach in time is math, they will, you'll find a professor, get on board, write all formulas, da 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 da. With math, now we can fax people, like send them through, like beam me up, Scotty. With math, it's possible to beam up something. And some places, in some laboratories now, it is possible to beam up like a bottle of water from here to there. Physically, like you see the bottle disappearing and appear there. Disintegration of the molecules. It can be done. Purpose of it is that we human one day will be just standing like under this one. That, and then you are far in Mecca.
To Morocco.
Yeah, Morocco. Yeah, okay, to make you happy, Morocco. That is going to be possible. How did Al-Quran mention this? Al-Quran mentioned this travel through time and things like that in the story of Sulaiman and the Queen Sheba, who had her throne in Al-Yemen, and he was in Palestine, that is over 1,000 miles away. To transport something from Al-Yemen to Palestine, it's not going to happen in a day or two. A jinn, with his power, what Allah has given him, the speed, he said, I can do it. Allah said, no, you don't do it. But there was somebody who had the knowledge of a book. He had a science, teletransportation. Before Sulaiman, he told him, I will get you now the throne of the Queen Sheba from Al-Yaman here before your eyelid closes and opens. When Sulaiman closed his eyelid and opened it, the throne was right in front of him.
Okay. That wasn't the Ifrit.
No, it wasn't the Ifrit. Now, when Allah, yeah, we'll see. Oh, you're gonna see the, how much of this book is really. Now, what Allah is telling us, at that time it was a miracle, right? Just like Sulaiman, when Allah gave him the power to use the wind. What did he do? He used to fly with the wind, with his armies and every planes. This happened like over 4,000 years ago. At that time, that it was a miracle for Sulaiman. But when Allah mentioned it in the Quran, he said that humans, you can do it. Go do it. Can we, ya Allah, today bring cars with our transportation from Japan to here? Yes, we can. It was done at the time of Sulaiman 4,000 years ago. This is why Al-Quran is an eternal law. Either you apply it or you don't. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah says every time the non-Muslims or the world, they find something, Al-Quran always is on top of them. Do you know why? Because every time they discovered something, we find it in Al-Quran. It's us Muslims who are stupid who don't look into this book. I find it strange that people tell you, you know, this kuffar, they actually stole their laws from Islam. Have you heard this?
Islamic Spain.
Yeah, and I tell someday I told them, because Muslims are idiots. They have it in the book and they didn't see it. And somebody else had to spend a lot of money to get it. People waste their time about when Rasulullah spoke about the dog. If he leaks in a plate, you wash it 6 times and 7 times with sand. What was Rasulullah? People, we Muslims are so idiots. It angers me to no end. Instead of looking at it, why sand? What does the sand kill that water doesn't kill? We dig in bacteria. We dig in bacteria and go there. But we don't. We just waste time. So, Al-Quran is not a dead book. When Allah talks about the children of Israel, Ya Bani Israel, even though it might seem like he's talking 400 years ago, okay? But he is talking actually now. Are the children of Israel existent amongst us or not? They are. I will give you an example. When I was in San Francisco living there, I used to, I used the sat-nav, you know the sat-nav belt in the car. Back in 1995, that's when I used it. I like that. Yes. 1995. Recently, it has become, and I go, to me, it's kind of like, big deal. What? I've used it 1995 in the United States. The car, the navigation, the lady turn right, go straight, do that. Right? Big deal. MP3 players. I used to have them like before 2000, 1997. We used to have MP3 players. They were not here. When I came with mine in England, they used to think it was a heart machine. A heart? Absolutely. Machine. One day, again, I came here on vacation and I had my card, my credit card. And on the back, it's written CID. CID. In the United States, they will ask you to look at the ID to make sure that the credit card goes along with the driver's license. And so I came here, and we used to have the machine, what you have today, you put it in the machine and you enter your chip and things like that. We used to have that in the United States back like 98, 99. Oh, cash machine, yes, drive-through even. But what I mean is when you put the card reader and you enter a PIN number so that they take money. Yeah. We used to have that like back in 97, 98. Okay. Yeah. Here it's only recently it came around. I remember one day I was in this music store. I wanted to buy something, software or something. And I gave my card to the guy and he turns to the signature and he goes, what's this? I go, that's my ID. And he goes, no, I needed you to sign here. I said, look, give me the chip reader and I'll enter my PIN number. He goes, what's that? I said, it's a machine where you put the card, it reads it and you put the number and you take the money. He said, you're making fun of me. I said, no, I'm not making fun of you. We got it. That was 10 years before it came here, So now I go to America, I see some technology and I come to you and I say, people of San Francisco, you can do it. Now, when I say people of San Francisco, you guys are from London, you're Londoners. But why did I use people of San Francisco? It's to give you the boost that they already have. It's to link you with them when it comes to the outcome of actions. Another example. You guys are going to go, Chelsea and Arsenal. Yeah, let's go. Yeah. Okay. I go, Arsenal always, who wins a lot of the cup? Chelsea wins a lot of the caps, cap. So, and now you are Arsenal people. And I come to you and say, come on, are you Chelsea people or not? What am I saying?
To be like, you need to think like Chelsea and be like Chelsea.
Absolutely. What it is that Chelsea has that you guys don't have, okay? Al-Quran didn't come to freeze us in an era. Another point, please take a picture so I can...
I will stop here. And tomorrow, inshallah, I will post the second part on how to interact with Ramadan. Again, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. To join my group, please send me a message on 0044 78 76 40 87 35. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullah, and have a wonderful day.